Okay, well, good afternoon. Welcome to week three of the wacky politics of 2016, a title I came up with a few months ago, but I think it's holding pretty accurately so far. Maybe you agree with that. So far, we've talked about the performance of the media. We talked with some debate experts about the first debate and the role of debates in our politics today. This week, campaign strategy. What's it like to run one of these basically fly-by-night campaigns that is a multi-million dollar company, if you will, that springs up very, very quickly? What's it like to oversee one of these things and guide it to a very successful finish, as Jeff did? We've got a terrific guest this week. I couldn't get a better guest for this topic. Jeff Roe was the campaign manager for Ted Cruz, guided Ted Cruz to a second place finish in what was the largest Republican field, the largest candidate field in a primary in American history. A lot of folks didn't give Ted Cruz a very good shot to begin with. Jeff Roe guided that campaign to a very strong second place finish, and I think you'll hear him talk today. There was probably a moment or two during the primaries when this primary campaign might have gone a different way, Trump being on the ropes for one of the few times in this campaign cycle, and Jeff was right there to bring this all along. Jeff is the founder of Axiom Strategies, a political consulting firm in Kansas City where I got to know Jeff. He has offices now around the country, Austin, Washington, out west. It's a burgeoning, growing outfit, much different than the outfit when I first got to know Jeff. He's a former chief of staff and a former aide to Congressman Sam Graves of Missouri, of Northwest Missouri. Jeff is known, and I'm sure many of you already know this, for his aggressive style of politics. Maybe the best quote I've ever heard him utter was his line that politics ain't beanbag. For Jeff Roe, politics has never been just beanbag. So with that introduction, ladies and gentlemen, say hello to Jeff Roe. Let's go with the news. You know, most recent development with Ted Cruz, he just endorsed Donald Trump. And a lot of folks are saying, scratching their heads, what was this all about?
Right.
Why did he do it? What did you make of it? What's been the fallout since he did it?
So he's on Thursday, he's raising money in Houston and Dallas for a bunch of his Senate colleagues.
Yeah.
And because you can only raise probably, there's only so much money you can raise and give away. You have to make tough decisions on who to support. And so he was looking around the field of his Senate colleagues, who's in trouble, who could be in trouble, who has a really tough spot, who's probably got their race locked away. But of course, everybody wants money. So you have to make real decisions. So we'd taken a look at a lot of polling and that sort of thing. This is a long way to answer your question, but it was very informative, at least for me, on how he makes decisions. And so when we were looking at the race in Florida to see if Marco Rubio really needed help. At that time, the NRSC, the National Republican Senatorial Committee, and the Democrat Senatorial Committee were both in, both spending about $2 million a week. And so he thought, so we took a look at that race, knowing that he'd want to help Marco if he thought Marco needed help. And after looking at the race, it's not a done deal by any stretch of the imagination. That's a $20 million race on both sides. We're going to raise probably $50,000 to $100,000. But hard money in a race like that, a critical time that they don't have to raise for themselves,
right,
is good money.
It matters.
It matters. And so when he looked at the presidential polling, he saw that there was about, that Hillary Clinton was getting, or is getting, that time, it's about 3 weeks ago, when Trump was on his upswing. Hillary was getting about 95-94% of Democrat, behavioral Democrats, to vote for her, and Trump was getting 82-83. And when you really looked at the data, when you sliced the data a little bit further, about half of those people were with Trump, that they were Jeb Bush type voters, mm-hmm, and about half of them were Ted Cruz type voters. And it was, you know, I don't want to make too much of the moment, but he said, I really could be the reason why Hillary Clinton gets elected, or at least contribute to it.
So you were behind the decision? Did you agree with it?
Oh, I don't make a habit of sharing behind closed doors. But
oh, come on.
Yeah.
Just whisper.
Nobody's here. Nobody has Twitter or anything. I mean, it'll be, they'll just stay among us friends. But I think he really, he also, to a certain degree, had put himself in a bit of a position that he said, don't write my name in. Now, he said that because no one should. But he also said it kind of a whimsical moment when somebody said, we want to write your name in, Ted, you know, kind of yelled it at him.
Yeah.
He said, do not do that. I'm not going to vote for Hillary Clinton. Then they asked him about Gary Johnson, and he said, I don't think third party options are viable. And so if you're not voting for Hillary, if you're not writing your own name in, don't write anybody in. Not voting third, you know, you're going to vote. You're a United States Senator, so you're going to have to cast a vote. That question is going to get hard to answer. You either voted for him or you didn't. And so that led to his statement, and also the right time where it might, you know, might make a difference before, as the world was turning to the debate, to do it in front of the debate. After the debate, it would have less impact because then the wheels are off and it's running downhill out of control. So it literally came down to, he wrote a long piece about it. It was him on Facebook, and it came down to a variety of issues, but one that took place during his decision time frame was he added people to his list of Supreme Court judges, a critical one being Mike Lee, who's his best friend, and who doesn't support Trump. So Trump was going out of his way to try and, you know, make this an easier decision for Ted. But secondly, and most importantly, because then the follow-up question is, well, how do you trust him, right? I mean, who knows? Who knows who he'll pick? No one can know. No one can know who anybody's going to pick. For sure, might not know who he would pick. But he said, I'm going to pick from this list.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the expanded list, and the nominee that I would pick if elected is going to come from this list. And Ted is a Supreme Court litigator. He's argued before the court 9 times. The Constitution is a love affair for him. He memorized it at the age of 13. You know, I like the Constitution.
You didn't memorize it.
I studied it, you know, here and there, I think. But I don't have a love affair with it. I want somebody that I trust to have one with it.
Yeah.
And so that was very impactful on him and his decision.
Critics were saying, what does Ted Cruz stand for now? He stands up before the Republican National Convention and says, uh-uh. And then a few months later, when Trump's rising the polls, he says, okay, I'll go there. The principled man that he's purported to be seems not to be that man anymore.
So there's, if you take a look at his speech, what he was trying to do in that speech, which he will confess he did not pull off, was to say to Donald Trump and his supporters, this is what it takes to get people like me to vote for the ticket. And it is a beholden commitment to uphold the Constitution and federalism. And if you look at that speech, not accidentally was it modeled after Reagan's speech for Ford. You look at it, I don't think anybody's going to, but if you do, watch the speech, ignore the kind of kerfluffle and the boos, but then listen to Reagan versus when he did not endorse Ford. Listen to Kennedy when he did not endorse Carter.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these were similarly tailored, support the ticket, support constitutional conservatives that you believe will protect the Constitution up and down the ticket. I mean, some of, in fact, you know, not plagiarized, but some remarkably similar wording. It's just, I think we're in a different time. That, and that also was the best speech that I've seen Ted Cruz give. Now, I was backstage when it happened. I went through all the machinations beforehand.
The Trump endorsement you're talking about.
No, the Trump non-endorsement
at the convention.
At the convention. Okay. And I actually thought, because there was, you know, a lot of back and forth, I actually thought listening to the speech, I know why everybody got out of control. First of all, the Trump people were, they have 1,000 people in their yellow hats, and they were juicing it up at the end. And no surprise, New York started booing first. And then Utah, right next to them, started booing New York. And then we're off to the races. But it did get out of control, for sure. But I even thought when he was delivering and practicing the speech prior, he would give it, and he'd give it with the teleprompters, and he was delivering it. I didn't feel the crescendo that I felt backstage when he was speaking. Even I looked over at our senior strategist, Jason Johnson, and I said, is he going to endorse him?
Well, because he paused at one point. There was a pregnant pause.
Right.
And on TV, I'm thinking, is he going to do it now?
I thought the same thing.
Oh, well, that, okay.
Yeah,
that's
news. I thought the same thing. I thought he might, because of the buildup that was going into the, now, I knew he wasn't going to, and I know he didn't intend to, and I knew what he was going to do, But there was so much, you know, anxiousness built up in
right.
the 20,000 people, and it was obviously a Hallmark speech for the convention, and you could just feel the pressure building. And just out of a normal mortal, in my opinion, would have just said, "And I support him." I'm just kind of vomited out.
Yeah.
Just to have the roof raised on the. But he has a man of conviction, and he also is a man of principle. And because of that, no single piece of this has been a politically smart decision. If you're going to endorse him or support him, you would do it in front of 30 million people at the national convention. And if you're later going to do it, you wouldn't do it on Facebook, you know, outside of 30 million people. So
I would agree with that. By the way.
He naturally came to this conclusion over a period of time. And prayer and thoughtfulness, and that's why in he doesn't connect in a way to us, because he just doesn't do what a normal politician would do. And I also think that's his charm, but it is an acquired taste for some.
Let's talk about yourself and your rise in politics. You always wanted to run a presidential campaign from time you got into politics. Why? Is that just because it's playing at the major league level, or what was the thinking?
I think, how about that?
Yeah.
And then I wanted the oceans to rise.
Do you believe in global warming?
So I think that there's a couple things. I'm very competitive. And when I first got a congressman elected, I thought, there is just nobody better at this than me. I just got a congressman elected. It was 2000. It was the closest race in the country, number one race in the country. There's about $8 million spent between the two sides. We beat an incumbent's son. And it's a big race, heady stuff. I'm 30 years old, going to D.C., chief of staff, $130,000 a year. I mean, this was like high cotton. And I'm the most brilliant man in America. And that's been disproven several times over now. But I went to Washington, and I realized that there was 435 other brilliant people. And that made me competitive to want to try and be among the best. And so I started, after being a chief of staff for four and a half years, I started my company to run campaigns. I was chief of staff during the off year, and then I'd come back and run the campaign in the on year. And I'll never forget, so I think I'm this, you know, super genius. And I come back and I'm speaking at a bridge dedication ceremony, or a railroad dedication ceremony, where they had at grade crossings, and they finally got this in Carrollton, Missouri. And they finally got arms on both sides. Normally you just drive, you know, look both ways and drive across it, but they got arms. And so the federal government, they gave it a grant, and so they brought this back, and so I was to speak. And they had the band was there. It was a big deal. Carrollton's a smaller town, pretty close to where I grew up, and it was about a $235,000 project. And I think Kit Bond or Roy Blunt or somebody got the money. And Sam had helped or signed a letter or something. So they had me speak. And the lady in charge is like, "You speak right at 2:32 to 2:35, because Sam couldn't make it. And so I get up, and there's a little bandstand of like the Chamber of Commerce people, and they turn everybody out. And so I roll up to this podium at 2:32. I start speaking, and literally the train comes rolling by.
Comes right by.
And I look over at Peggy, so I speak, and I got 3 minutes, and nobody can hear me. And so the train passes, and I get done, and I look at her, and she's walking up. I said, "You want me to say that again?" She said, "No, you were right on time." So I decided that it was on time to probably go elect some more people. And so so we started running campaigns across the country. And what I discovered is the one race that you could really run that's not unique to a state is a federal race for Congress. The issues are the same. The federal policy issues are the same. You can have some uniqueness. You know, we have a border district in Tucson that's much different than a north central Missouri district. But for the most part, the issues are the same, the candidates are the same, the money's the same, the fundraising ability's all the same. So we started building a company that elected congressmen, and we've now elected 52. We have 52 members of Congress on the ballot this fall. That then, after doing a few of those, I wanted to do Senate and then governor. And so we started to do those, and to impact, there's two things that happens when a president takes the oath of office that is the most impactful that no member of Congress, no governor, no senator can do. And that's impact the world stage from a foreign policy standpoint and from an executive order standpoint. So everybody talks about how, well, even if they get elected, they can't change that much. That's not accurate.
Mm-hmm.
They'll change the world instantly. That's a hesitation for some people, both for Hillary and for Donald, Mr. Trump, I guess we call him. So impacting the stage. I'm a pig farm kid from Brookfield, Missouri. For me to find myself in the room, even in the room or in the building with the same people that make those kind of impact on my profession and my country, that's a pretty profound opportunity and honor. And so I tried to seek that level of participation to make that much more of an impact.
So why did Ted Cruz hire you in 2012, you worked against him when he ran for the Senate the first time. In fact, in one of your pieces, he found so incendiary that you had, Cruz pulled it out as a prop during a debate and denounced his opponent for daring to question his patriotism. And yet, a couple years later, he's hiring you to run his campaign for the presidency of the United States. How did that happen?
He's probably still asking himself that question. So it's a neat story. I won't belabor it too much because it's a little bit personal and I don't want to get overshare in front of a group of people. But so I approached it the way I would approach anything else in politics. I thought about who could win, who could raise the most money, what their chances would be, where would we want to live? Because if you run a presidential campaign, everything else is gone, like almost literally gone. You move your family, you rent a house, you live next to the campaign office, it's all in. And so that's a family decision. So my wife and I talked about it, and I was laying out the case. I knew Mr. Bush and a lot of the people on his team. I had known and done some work for Scott Walker. I knew, I worked for Mr. Huckabee in the past, I worked for Mr. Perry in the past. Right. I knew all these people. And so I'm walking through with Missy, my wife's name is Missy. And we had a young daughter on the way at the time. We knew we were pregnant, we just didn't know what we were gonna have. And so I said, here's all these things, like, what do you think of Madison, Wisconsin? And she's like, I don't know, what are you talking about? And so I said, well, that's what Scott Walker's campaign office will be there. What about Miami, Marco Rubio? I could probably get on there. And so I went back and forth, and I always thought that maybe I could be top two. I probably wouldn't have done everything if I couldn't have been top two or three in the campaign. And so she said, well, why, and she, this is a true story. She said, well, if you're gonna move, leave your company, uproot us from Kansas City, go do this, crazy thing, wouldn't you wanna do it for somebody that would completely take the country in 180 degree from where it is today? And she said that wouldn't establish some blue ribbon commission to see if we should repeal all of his executive orders. And I said, yeah. And I said, okay, who do you think that is? And I said, wait. So I pulled out my BlackBerry. She wrote on the back of it, we were at a restaurant. She wrote it down, I typed it in my BlackBerry, and we both flipped it over. It said Ted Cruz. And I said, well, I don't know him. I don't know anybody with him. And oh, by the way, I helped run a campaign against him. And like a loving wife, she said, oh, you'll figure all that out. And so I said, upon a 3-month, my firm had a lot of people. I told them I wanted to do this, but several months out. And so they each took a piece of the previous campaigns and studied it for 6 months, wrote a big 250-page binder about how a presidential campaign is constructed and operated and managed. And so they'd been working on it a long time, and so I said, okay, let's figure out Ted Cruz now. And so we did a big research project. I spent 4 months trying to get in front of him, finally did, through a friend of a friend, just like all these things happen. And I had an hour, and the scheduler told me that I had an hour with him, and she said, don't be offended if he doesn't talk a lot or if he ignores you or looks at his iPhone, like he's busy, and you better be prepared for a half hour is what she was telling me. Mm-hmm. And so 4.5 hours later, I felt like I had it and I wanted to close it. And so I said, I really need to know by Friday. This is a Tuesday. So not only hadn't even decided for sure he's going to run yet, but that was to join his national team. And so he called on Friday. So that was kind of there's another hour and a half behind that story, but that was the punchline. I sought him out to try and run, because I believed he was a person that had the ability to, first of all, he fit all my political objectives, but I also think if he elected the steel spine that he has, that he would absolutely put the brakes on where we're going and change the direction.
You said what to him during that? Are there one or two things that you said to him or things that you did during those 4.5 hours that got you the job? Because this is a job that has changed your career and made you arguably the hottest Republican political consultant in the country.
So that's kind. I'm not sure if that's true. But he went to the restroom a lot, so he was drinking a lot of Sprite. That helped. So that built some time. He took a couple calls. That helped too. You know, I had a pitch. I had an elevator pitch, but it had 5 points. But when you have the 5 points, and you got about an hour for each, you got to drag it out. My points were that we purposely had gone to run races in states that had primaries. And I know people, so I went and pitched races in Iowa for several cycles in a row, doing races in Iowa to get a knowledge of the state. I went and hired somebody from New Hampshire to really know the New Hampshire in that state. I did races in South Carolina. I tried to balance our portfolio of campaigns that we operated to go to early primary states. So by the time I was pitching him, I had done 56 states in the first 11, 56 campaigns in the first 11 states. I almost pulled an Obama there with 56 states. There's a reason he did that, by the way, is because it's 57 states and territories, and when you're campaigning across the country, those seven territories could be pretty meaningful. But anyway, and so I said, I don't know that anybody else has done as many campaigns in these early states as I have done. I manage, my firm managed $100 million of political money that I was solely responsible for. There's not a lot of people who've managed that much money routinely. I've operated a staff, the Axiom employees, we've had 511 employees over now 11 years, and at any given time, somewhere between 50 and 75, I manage staff, I know how to do that. You know, I said, I feel like I'm okay in political knowledge and political chops, but you could probably find somebody better in each of those things. But if you did find somebody better in each of those, I don't know if they'd have them all. And then I don't know if they'd move to Houston, which before I got there seemed a little godforsaken to me with the heat. And then I don't know if they would believe what you believe intellectually and politically. So I said, I think I'm the only one you could hire. That's a little Jeff Roe for you. But and so I think what I was trying to strike him on is not that I'm some political Svengali, but a political campaign and a presidential campaign is much management, money management, people management. I mean, I learned so much about myself and about people in the course of it, because it is, like you alluded to in your opening, it is a startup company. You start with $0, and you might not make it a month. And so you can't get your spending ahead of your fundraising. That's why campaigns go broke. It is a cool thing to run for president. I've seen it up close. It's why John Kasich, I think, is still running. It's because it's cool. And it's because the reason why they drop out is not because it's because they get tired of running. It's because they don't have the money to get on the plane to go fly there. And so the money management is critical. The people management and how you hire people and how you build the campaign is critical. And so I really pitch them on those things more than any of the political successes.
Well, you're all about money management. In fact, I read somewhere that even during the hot summer months in Houston, you made a real point after 6 o'clock in the evening of turning off the air conditioning to save so much money during the course of the campaign. Is that a true story?
So that's a little bit taken out of context. I mean, the building shuts the air conditioning off. I just didn't restart it. And so
you're saving money, though.
Yeah, it was $158 an hour, and I mean, I figured out how many hours we're going to be in there and how much that would cost. And I mean, these are people. Our campaign was funded. We raised $92.7 million $92.7 million that we raised. That's $30 million more than anyone else has ever raised. All these big time candidates for president, $30 million more. And we did that by having about 55,000 people give us $50 a person. We would raise about $1.7 million a month based on people given monthly contributions. We'd raise about $400,000 a week based on people given given weekly contributions. And when you talk about people sending you $50, and it's going to keep, like, I can buy a fan for $50 and never have the air conditioning on. I mean, I wasn't going to shut it off. I mean, it came with our rent during the day. But I wasn't going to waste people's money. We would, you know, there's always these pizza parties, and, you know, campaigns are known for having, you know, beer and wine and happy hour. Well, our campaign, so no money in liquor, no wasteful. There just wasn't any wasteful spending because, one, to honor the people that gave it, and then, two, because if we didn't have it, we were going to have to get out of the race. And so it is.
And you
want
to set
critical.
A culture, I read,
it's
too.
A culture.
There's a culture you're trying to, a template you're trying to set for the operation you're trying to run.
Yeah, we had no consultants, so we had people, nobody, you know, actually we had one person that would kind of come in during the week, but everybody moved to Houston. We had, at the height, we had 158 people.
Right.
And of those 158, three were from Houston. So everybody moved there. This was unusual to campaigns I'd been on. Typically, you'd fly in on a Monday, you'd fly out on a Friday, and you know, you'd stay in a hotel, and the campaign would reimburse you. We bought dorms all over the country, would lease these dorms of defunct private schools, a lot of them, or technical schools, and we put all of our volunteers and our staff in these dorms. Like, that was just the culture. We were there for a reason. We were there for an opportunity of a lifetime. We can never recreate. Even if he runs again, some of this won't be recreated. And so, yeah, it's, I think, honoring the people's money that we're giving real sacrificially to us. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, we had a lady, I don't want to talk a lot about it because I kind of get emotional about it sometimes, but this lady brought her girl, her daughter in, who brought us a piggy bank with $56 in it. Like, you don't waste that money.
Hmm. When did you know that Donald Trump was going to be a serious challenger? What was the, you remember the moment, the time? Because you didn't think so right away, did you?
I didn't. So when he came down the escalator, I actually texted a buddy of mine that worked for him, and I said, nice job, exclamation part, kind of mocking him a little bit. I thought he'd mock it. And he texts back, he goes, wasn't that awesome? I'm like, holy crap, they meant to do that. I knew he had something there, but I think I went to the state fair with Ted in that summer of 15.
In Iowa?
In Iowa. Mm-hmm. And we came back, and we did some polling and data testing that we got back before Labor Day. And we had, he was sharing votes with us. He was sharing votes. So if, in polling, you test who you want to vote for, and then we test who's your second choice. That's a really critical question in a multi-candidate field. So who's your, if you, that person wasn't there, who's your second choice? And so he was our second choice. He was Rubio's second choice. He was Ben Carson's second choice. He was Jeb Bush's second choice. Like, he was so,
wide.
You know, wide that we knew if we just called him a liberal, that would hurt him with our 25% of the vote, but it wouldn't hurt him with some of the other vote. And so we knew then that he was getting such a wide swath that he'd, I kind of hate when people say tapped into. It's really not tapped into. I mean, what happens is Republicans have been saying, Republicans, members of Congress and senators to Washington for the last decade, if they just send us a few more people, then we're really going to change Washington this time. And they just got pissed off and fed up. And so he harnessed that in a way by saying some things that, you know, at best can be considered reckless. But he was saying things that people were saying to us. That's what Ted Cruz will do, because Ted Cruz has proven that he will hold politicians accountable. But Donald Trump, and by the way, our economy's changed, like a lot of things have changed lately in our economy and in our system, that a businessman is attractive because you don't need this bartering system among politicians on who's going to give money for what, you know, transportation project or railroad bridge project. Like, they don't care about horse trading. They want a job. And so a businessman becomes much more attractive in that way. And so that's the same for a Jeb Bush supporter as it is for a Ted Cruz supporter. And the disappointing part of this is we really need to have that fight in the party on, are we a Jeb Bush party or are we a Ted Cruz party? I think we're on tap to have that party, that fight, without Donald in the race. But Donald, around Labor Day, to answer your question in a shorter fashion, and around Labor Day is when
we
got the data.
So you see that poll, and you begin to think, uh-oh.
Yeah, who's going to take him out? Like, we're all going to have to get in a room, sing Kumbaya, and all take him out and strap bombs to our chest all at the same time. And, like, somebody's going to stand back and not pull the pin. Because we watched Bobby Jindal run up and get blown up. We watched Rick Perry run up and get blown up. We watched Scott Walker run up and get blown up. Like, there wasn't a lot of incentive for us still at, you know, 30 or 40% name ID in Iowa. I mean, we're still trying to build our name ID. There's no reason for us to go run up and try and blow him up. And so we never got in the room, ever. We had a lot of conversations, particularly towards the end, to get in the room together, but nobody ever got in the room together and said, let's join up, and I'll take the liberals away from him, and I'll take the moderates, and I'll take the social conservatives, and I'll take the economic conservatives. Like, that never happened, because we all thought, if we get him heads up, we'll beat him.
That was always the objective.
That was always the objective.
One-on-one.
And I'm sure, like, I can't be immune, you know, only for me.
You have said we will never see a candidate like Donald Trump ever again.
Yeah, I think he'd win the Democrat primary if he would run as a Democrat. Like, he's not that far. I mean, if he's pro-choice and he's pro-gay marriage, if he's pro-choice, that's the only thing that would, like, and I guess he'd have to be some sort of gun control, which he's has written about that he's for. I'm not sure anymore. But I don't think it's a pox on the Republican House like a lot of people do. If he would have, I mean, Bernie Sanders took Hillary to the mat. If Donald Trump ran as a Democrat, he would have won their nomination. That's how much.
That's remarkable, what you just said. That's unbelievable.
It is. Well, I mean, look at it. Trade, that's a central issue. Wall Street, I mean, he would have won, you know, thankfully he didn't run as a third party, because then we might have third parties for now, you know, forever afterwards. But no, if he would have decided to, you know what, I'm going to be a Democrat, and I'm going to be kind of one of these Democrats that kind of a pro-union, pro-choice but not reckless, anti-gun but not reckless, anti-trade, protect the jobs.
Right.
I'm a Democrat.
Off
he
you go.
Cleans her clock.
That's interesting. I want to go back to running a campaign. You have said, I've heard you say this many times, you're all about data. You function, you base your decisions not on gut instinct, as I think many folks think you guys base your decisions on, but you base your decisions on data. What kind of data? What are you talking about?
So be prepared to be a little freaked out about it. We do have strong privacy laws. But
having said
there's polling as a precondition of how you view a race is really a cycle away from everybody else realizing that it's dead. It's actually dead now because they allow too many variables into the polling data. For instance, try and call somebody that's worth over $100,000 and get them on their phone and their landline or their cell phone. Try and get their cell phone and try and call them on the landline and have them answer. Try and call a poor person. Try and call these different groups where you would allow, if you call one rich person, you would allow that person to count for 2.7 people. So in a survey of 1,000 people, if you assume 1% of the people make over $250,000, you're going to have to call 10 people. You'd only have to call 3. That's always a standard in polling. That's been the standard forever. Well, now that gets as high as 10 or 11 or 12 people that one connect counts on. So that's why polling is busted. We can't get a hold of people. The incident rate.
Because people are trying to do it more cheaply.
Well, they won't pay them more money because they can't get enough people on the phone. The number of people that even answer the phone and then get all the way through to the end of the call is like 30%. I mean, it's just crazy. So what analytics does is we could take, so if we're polling in the 3rd congressional district in Kansas, we would pull a sample of about 20 or 30,000 people, their phone numbers, cell phones and live numbers, and then call them until we got to 500, got a statistically relevant sample, and then provide the results. Well, with analytics, we have every data part for every single person. So if you're trying to get a Republican soft, you know, Republican-leaning independent female, and that is 10% of the votes, well, there's 800,000 people in this district. We're going to have the data for 80,000 people, not for what they represent out of 400 people or 500 people that we poll. So what's allowed this to happen is, and I lose people quickly on this.
I'm sort of getting this.
Yeah. So if you, what happens is instead of assuming values to, instead of me saying, Steve Kraske, I don't know what he believes, but I know what people that live in a cul-de-sac and this part of Johnson County think, because I've talked to 3 people in cul-de-sacs there. Now I know how you think, because I have 10,000 data parts on you, on your credit card usage, on your
magazines,
all the subscriptions, all the cars.
Like, you know all this stuff.
All that, but I used to always kind of know that, but it was anonymized. But now I know it about you. And I know how to advertise to your phone versus at night if you use a tablet versus a laptop during the day. So now I could deliver and service ads to people based on how they function. I can run an ad to the kitchen for one set of people, another for the living room or the bedroom.
That's
different ads to different people. And so that's why direct mail has a longer tail on it for life expectancy. It's not going to outlive the postal service, but it's because you could direct target into a home, and so we send one piece of mail for one person in the home and another piece of mail for the other person in the home. We can do, so anyway, aside from phones and calling people and assuming they're going to answer, which doesn't happen, people just text. My mom, like, anyway, everybody's texting, it's crazy. People just need to pick up the phone and talk, but If you try to get that information from a phone call with someone, you can't get it, so you can purchase it. It's legally permissible. Now, there are some anonymized features of it where you don't know exactly who you're talking to, but there are some services like dish, you know, satellite TV, where if you get your internet and your cable and your satellite through the same service provider, we know a lot.
But the data for you is your lifeblood.
Yeah. I mean, I just don't think I'm smart enough to figure out what everybody thinks.
So you want
I require them to tell me.
Something else I read about you, you talked a lot in this campaign about the importance of something called media share as being perhaps the most important factor in presidential politics today. In a sentence, what is media share? What are we talking about there?
The amount of earned media, well, sentence. How much it would cost to replace the free media that you received.
Okay. Where's the free media going? Who are newspaper reporters covering?
Yep.
What are we spending our time?
Yep.
So I'm the most important factor in presidential politics today.
You and your colleagues on TV are.
Yeah, okay.
No, you're not the most important. You're the most predictive. So since we've had TV, TV's done more than newspaper, but one begets the other. So
if Ted Cruz is getting 30% of all the media attention, that begins to indicate in a 15-candidate field that right now he's the horse.
That's right. So so that's why when Trump at that time, remember, he had said what he said about John McCain, he said all the things, he said a lot of the things were supposed to end his political career. He'd already said them by then. And when we had three TVs right outside my office, CNN, MSNBC, and Fox, and it was routine that I would go out and they would be wall, we call it the full Trump, and they'd have the full Trump up. Like all three are covering him wall to wall for rallies. We got the full Trump like a dozen times in the entire campaign. About half of those were bad. But even if you take a look at the purpose of the full Trump, like even if it was bad, it's still soaking up media share. And so the value of that over time becomes an impenetrable advantage because you can't advertise your way out of it. There are four things that people care about or that are most predictive about a presidential campaign. One is the endorsements that you get. Throw those out the window today. I mean, we actually won the endorsement fight. It's called the invisible primary is what it's routinely called. How much money you raise, which is a pretty good indicator of just public support and blah, blah. Then your essentially, it's the two breakdowns of press. One is endorsements, and two is your share of the media. And so, media share we would measure not just on TV and newspaper, but also in social. And Trump got $3.1 billion worth of free advertising in the campaign.
Compared to Cruz's,
we were in second place, and we got $684 million.
And that factor, more than the money, more than the endorsements, it was that factor that drove this campaign.
Yeah, and I mean, that's kind of like whining about, you know, the sun coming up. So I mean, part of that is on us. We wrote, I've still yet to deliver it and edit it and everything else, so nobody's seen this yet, but we have about a 200-page autopsy of our campaign. I don't want to break news in case some in our campaign's watching, because I've not even read the whole thing yet. We hired a person who was on our campaign to write the book on our campaign. Not the book like you sell, but like the book for internal use. And
for me to look at.
And for you, to leak to you and tell the good things about me. You take a big part of the critique on us. When you say that, it's humbling that you would say that, because you've seen a lot of campaigns about how, you know, brilliant I am and everything. But the reality is I had one job to do, and that was to sell Ted Cruz and make him likable, and we didn't get that done. So my number one charge in life, besides not taking the campaign into bankruptcy, was to do that, and I didn't get it done. We have several self-critiques and candidate critiques that he's well aware of things that we could have done a little different, but we needed a different approach if we're going to take him on a cycle like this.
You wanted to break a lot of rules. You set out to break a lot of rules. You broke a lot of rules, but you said to me a little bit ago you didn't break enough rules.
Yeah, I don't. There's part of this that I'm not sure how much strategy is behind it, but we had a window on election night in Wisconsin, where it was the fifth state we'd won in a row. He was calling everything rigged. Never heard that before or since.
He being Trump.
Yeah, Trump was calling it rigged.
And we beat him.
We beat him bad. I mean, we thumped him in Wisconsin. He was all in Wisconsin. Even when we were really confident he was going to win, he was still going to Wisconsin. And we had just won on the both electorally, like, and in caucuses, and won five in a row. And you know, it was a real critical time in the institute we're sitting in, where he had a big assist from Mr. Dole, his endorsement at that time. If we were going to be able to break the stranglehold on the getting moderates to vote for Cruz, Mr. Dole would have been a leading indicator of that, and he supported Trump right around that kind of time.
Did you try to get him?
No, I didn't call Bill early enough, I don't think is what happened.
No, I'm kidding.
You know, we didn't play the – we believed that they would come, one. And two, we tried some. It didn't occur to me to try Mr. Dole, but he was a leading indicator of where a lot of those people were going to go, which is essentially to either be for Trump softly or just to stay out. And we got a lot of people. I mean, Cory Gardner and Ben Sasse, and we got a lot of leading officials. But we never quite cracked the code on how to get people that had been really against Ted universally to get them on board.
But ultimately, Jeff, was your timing just wrong? Because you picked a cycle, you ran against a guy you just said could have perhaps won the Democratic presidential nomination. He won the Republican presidential nomination. We've never seen anybody like this guy before, and this is the guy you were running against.
Yeah, well, that helps me sleep at night.
Well, is it true?
I don't know. I don't accept like failure, so I don't want to be like Fonzie where I can't say I'm sorry or something. But it's really hard for me to say. You know, when people talk about our campaign, other campaigns, I can't imagine saying another campaign was better than mine.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of my colleagues, to their grace, that I'm not equipped with. They say our campaign was really good. That's a cool thing for people to say. But we lost when, you know, it's the highest office in the land. Everything's fair game. It's the toughest in the business. The best people are playing it. And we lost on the battlefield. And so I just can't imagine that, oh, if it wasn't him, everybody would have lost to him. That's an easy thing to say. And others have said that. But I would never say that. We should have won.
I'm going to ask one more question, then I'm going to turn it over to you guys in the audience here. You would have done what differently? With the benefit of hindsight, are there one or two decisions, and again, having read about what you've said since the campaign, you said there are a zillion decisions, of course,
that's a lot.
You would do, but are there one or two big ones that you sort of point at and still wince over?
You know, I used to say this all the time about, I have a 2.5-year-old daughter, Remington, I have a 4-month-old daughter, Reagan, and so what I'm really good at in life is umpiring. So I used to umpire all the way through college. I did college umpire.
Baseball
umpiring. And so I always used to say this, and it's funny. I used to say this, and now it actually bit me, is I always said if I ever umpired my own kid's softball or baseball game, I would probably have a bigger strike zone for them than everybody else because I'd be fearful that they would be accusing me of having too small of a zone. So if the ball bounced, they'd probably have to hit it or they'd be struck out. We lost Missouri. And
for a
really close race.
Really close race.
And when you're in Houston and you're the presidential campaign manager, a guy from Texas, and you're from Missouri, and you lose your home state, luckily a lot of people didn't rub it in, but the decision was made. I made the decision to stay in Illinois, and I feared a little bit that it would be, oh, you're just trying to go to Missouri to win Missouri bigger, to make yourself look better. I literally had that kind of thought. And in a remarkably conflict-free campaign, that was a conflict that I struggled with, and it was just without a doubt. The riots happened, not riots, but the fights at Trump's Springfield, Illinois rally that he had. They had a big, you know, protest, and it blew up, and it was news for the whole weekend, and the Super Tuesday was the following Tuesday, and we were close in North Carolina. We were close in Missouri. We were down one in Missouri, down two in North Carolina, but yet most of the delegates were in Illinois. And so we thought maybe if we stayed in those collar counties, we could pick a bunch of those up.
In Chicago, yeah.
In Chicago, and it just backfired. It made him stronger rather than weaker. We had this thought potentially that it would be like, oh my gosh, we can't nominate him. It's going to be bedlam, and all these people are going to be protesting Republicans, and it's going to ruin our party. And we were still stuck in that mind frame, and so that wasn't smart. You know, the other thing is the Kasich thing kind of sucked.
This Kasich thing that he didn't get out of the race.
Well, that's super sucked.
That's a political term, super suck. Yeah, we'll deal with it later.
Yeah. I don't know what state he was waiting to win. I don't get that. But anyway, I've complained about that openly enough. When we cut the deal with him, which he honored and we did too, he would leave Indiana and we would not campaign in New Mexico or Washington. And that had the smack. So we won Wisconsin and then we were going into New York. We're going to get our clock cleaned. We knew that, and then Delaware is a suburb, and all the all these states coming up are going to be bad, and so we had to pick a place to make our last stand, and so we picked Indiana because we had 2 weeks, and we could move people in and really do a good campaign there. Had money kind of we could raise between the time, and so we were looking for any advantage. We named Carly Fiorina. I do not believe that was a mistake. I don't know, it was unorthodox, but that's breaking all the rules again.
As her vice presidential running mate,
and we were trying to get media share. Mm-hmm. That was the only day in the 2 weeks since New York that we won is the day we picked her. And then also we had two people that the press would cover and we could split up the state. Going to California, I can make a million. But I think probably the two most difficult ones, the most painful ones is for me personally is the Missouri piece and the and probably the Kasich doing that deal. It proved what everybody assumed, which is not assumed, but that Republicans would just do anything to beat, establishment would do anything to beat Trump.
Was there a lot of behind the scenes talk, negotiating with other campaigns to get Trump?
Like less than you would think, less than you would read about in political thrillers, but more than maybe you'd expect.
You're talking to each other.
Yeah, I mean, we see each other at debates. Media share was huge from the debate standpoint, which is why when we didn't get a debate with Trump, heads up, I mean, he was very smart to not allow a debate, and nobody was screaming for him. We were trying to get him to do it, and he would not debate, and it was a smart thing he could do because it wasn't so much that we could beat him in a debate one-on-one. It was that we would get the similar attention.
You'd stand next to him, yeah.
And so he never wanted that, and that was a really smart play on his part. But when when you're at those debates, the entire political universe is in one small town, not small town, one small area for 48 hours. And so, and it's a little bit of a, you talk there. Yeah, I mean, that's where you talk. It's easy to meet. We staved off a Trump-Cruz fight in Vegas before the Vegas debate with a meeting at Trump Tower or Trump Hotel. No surprise. You can cut some deals with your, and for the most part, the other campaign managers in the field, we're mostly in our 40s or most 30, at least high. Yeah, I think everybody's probably 40, at least 35 plus to 50 and long enough in the tooth that we wouldn't lie to somebody else even for political advantage. We just wouldn't say it.
Can you cut a deal without your principal right there next to you? We're not going to go into Washington State. We're going to stay out and in exchange you do this, and that's what we're going to do.
So in a presidential campaign, there's a lot of candidate management, but it's less so. I mean, these guys are thoroughbreds, and I've never seen anybody perform like Ted Cruz performed. In fact, so much so that it made us lazy on preparation. But he's a political junkie himself. You can cut that deal, but
you yourself could cut the deal.
Yeah, but you need principal buy-in on stuff like that.
Yeah. Let's go to some questions here. We got some microphones around the room. Thanks for being patient.
This is where it gets bumpy.
No, it won't.
If you're live streaming, I'm going to meet every Democrat right now.
Yeah. There we go. Yes, sir.
Donald Trump will not represent my party.
I just can't get over this feeling. I've had this feeling for several months now that Trump doesn't really care one way or the other whether he wins or loses this contest for president. What he really wants is the media coverage and TV, radio, and print to help build the name Trump because he plans on making quite a bit of money off the name Trump after
he wants media
over.
Share, you're saying. Yeah.
I've been with him in person. Some things that I see in person with him is you see in public, but the person, but the, and a lot of people say this, so I don't want to like overly kind of mentally, you know, psychologically profile it, but a lot of what he does on stage is actually that is a show. I mean, he is putting on a show for the people in the crowd, and I'm not saying he doesn't believe it, or but it doesn't resemble quite what you see in person. But I think that was true. I would agree with you about the seriousness and really wanting to win until South Carolina. And in the South Carolina primary, if you all recall, and my days get mixed up because it's such a blur, but Scalia died, I think, the day of the debate or the day before the debate. I think it was the day of the debate, actually. It was the day of the debate. And that really, we thought that was going to benefit us. That here's a Supreme Court litigator, and like, this is now no longer is a theoretical if we're going to get a new court or not, and all these 5-4 decisions, and now they're all going to get flipped, and oh my gosh, this is really going to happen. And it's Scalia of all people, like, this is a train wreck, but it's, you know, politically, this is probably advantageous to Cruz because he's the most conservative, and he knows the most about the court, he put the most conservative judge, but it actually helped Trump. And the way it helped Trump, and I could see it in his mind too, is that he knew at that point that whoever won the nomination, all the Republicans had to support him because of the court. And now that's in fact started to happen. And I think until that time, I saw the way he changed a little bit and the way his team behaved. I think we view it that way because it would seem so simple also to not take swings at people beneath you. But in New York and the way he was brought up and the business he's in, he's going to respond to every single slight, and it doesn't matter if it's politically advantageous or not. And so that, I see why people arrive at that conclusion. I currently, and I've had that thought fleeting across my mind, but I think today I don't question his desire to win.
TJ.
Hi, Ms. Roe. Thank you so much for coming. Glad to have you. So I think one of the most surprising things for Mr. Cruz was that he did not garner the support of the evangelical voters like he was expecting to. Instead, a lot of them flocked to Mr. Trump despite his multiple marriages and malfeasance throughout life, within his business, whatever. So could you speak to how you think that might have happened, what might have been actually driving the evangelical voters besides for just perhaps a religious belief or religious rhetoric? Thank you.
Yep. So we won the evangelical vote, but your point's not lost. Where we did in exit polling lose it is if in a couple states. So we won the young vote. We won the millennial vote in almost every state. About 18 states had exit polls. Where we lost the evangelical vote is in the South, where the people that self-described as evangelical in a survey outpaced the people that said that they were born again. So when our goal was, so in my mind, the word evangelical got a little bastardized during the process, because being an evangelical in the South is like joining a golf club. I mean, it is a social status. But if you're a Christian, and you believe that Christ died for your sins, then that is by virtue of that, you are a born-again churchgoer. Now, I'm not making declarations on whether you should go to church or not. I think we all fail in life before the eyes of the Lord. But people that were self-identifying as evangelicals because somebody was asking them, are you an evangelical, versus our target audience, which were born-again churchgoers. And that was a real target. So when I say a target, I mean, that's because Ted, he was son of a preacher. I mean, this is like not something he just does for political relevance. But when you talk about the building blocks of the party, it typically, if people know your heart and know your soul, is another way for us to also communicate Ted's heart and soul without it being some sort of speech. But if you know a person's faith, you're more likely to trust them on a balanced budget amendment or the way they deal with ISIS or things like that. And so when Trump did well in that group, it was because, and he did well. I mean, he did not win born-again churchgoers, but the self-identified evangelicals, which don't fit that description, he would win, and that's because they're pissed off. I mean, people, here's what has to happen in the country. For the nation to be successful and for our country to be great, three things really had to happen for somebody to not be poor, you have to get a college or get a high school diploma, have a willingness to work hard, and wait until you're married to have children. If those three things happen, you are good. You are not going to be poor in this country. This is just math. You can let one of those go. You probably can't be lazy, but you might be able to be lazy if you do the other two. You don't have to have a college degree, or I'm just keep on saying college. You say you have a high school degree or a high school diploma. You can actually get by without that now if you work hard and wait to have children. And you can also have children early as long as you have the other two. But if you fail two of the three, the likelihood is that you're going to be poor in this country. So when you are, that's been what we've always lived by. And you go to work and you get a job when you're 22 years old or 18 years old. My dad went to work for Southwestern Bell when he was 19 years old and worked till he got the watch and then he retired. George Brett stayed with the Royals the whole time. Now people are going to work for 8, 9, or 10 different companies. We have a different economy. And so when you're 40 or 50 years old and you lose your job, that's a damn problem. That's a mess. And when you see people getting wealthy and wealthy off government, then it makes you pissed off. As much as it makes you want to make sure that the person's really pro-life, that you're putting in charge of it. And so that's when the whole, we came out of the field in August, I soapboxed myself a little bit. That was me speaking, not Ted. When we came out of Iowa and he was competitive with us as a second choice among those voters, it spoke to the anger of the people that have played by the rules, done what it takes to be successful in life, and they don't see the same, they don't get to retire with the company that they started with because China stole their jobs or Mexico stole their jobs or somebody took it from them. And so that's the philosophy, and that's that. Unfortunately, those jobs, I mean, I hope he brings them back or Hillary brings them back. I hope they all create jobs. But the reality is we're in a service economy and a knowledge economy, and people are going to lose their job, and they're going to, like, get two or three other companies to hire them. I mean, that's the way the economy is going to go. That's a tough lesson for young kids, but it's a tougher lesson for people that are in some of these states, like New Hampshire, where drugs are now, which never a problem 10 years ago, now with job losses, I mean, people are looking to dark ways to handle some of their personal crises, and those people have a real problem on their hands when you can't. I mean, I was in Houston the other day. I live in Houston. Well, I was there the other day, and I stopped to get gas, and there was a gal next to me that put $5 in her tank, $5 of gas in her car. When you're putting $5 of gas in your car, like, there's a reason. You're not topping off. Like, that's the amount of money that you have. And when people are having that kind of problem, they're a little bit less interested in, particularly in how socially conservative you are and who's, you know, to be in charge of our economy.
Claire.
Hi, thanks for coming. There was a clip of Senator Cruz on Hannity last night that kind of touched on some of the media coverage you were talking about the Alicia Machado, Miss Piggy, Miss Housekeeping, that Senator Cruz remarked that they had heard the same kind of rumors already about Trump, and the media told them they weren't interested until August or September of this year. Did you feel any of that kind of pushback, or what's the media? I mean, that's a very interesting comment to say on the national news.
Okay? Yeah. He said it last night on Fox?
Yeah, on Hannity.
He was on Hannity?
Oh, no, they were showing a clip of
Hannity.
Oh, I'm like,
yeah. He's not quite ready to go on Hannity, I don't think. Yeah, I didn't see the clip, but I know what happened. I don't know exactly what he's talking about in the Miss Universe. I had not heard that. I actually saw a note to our op researcher, like, why didn't we know this? But he attacked the Mexican judge in March. And it was right before March 15th. And we're like, and on Twitter, it's not like he hit it or said it in some secret recording. He attacked Curtel, whatever his name is. He attacked the Mexican judge. Like, this is a candidate for president attacking a judge that's in charge of his case. Are you going to write on this? And they're like, oh, no, that's not a big deal. He does that all the time. And then remember when he attacked the Mexican judge after he had the nomination, it was like, look what we found and unearthed from a, you know, stockpile of garbage. So we had it all the time. We have a tape, not some secretly obtained tape. We have a tape of him on PBS in New York where he rants about how great Barack Obama is. I mean, he goes on and on and on, but great president and all this kind of stuff. And yeah, well, that'd be news in the general. I mean, they put pushback. So the reality is, I don't want to get too conspiratorial about it because this will be likely taped and it'll likely be sent, although I don't fear Roger Ailes anymore. Maybe if he's doing Trump TV, I'll fear him. But there's a financial decision involved. It can't not be involved. When you have
You're saying by the media there was, I've heard you say this before,
yeah.
By the media, yep. In terms of the way it covered this race.
Without question.
There were financial decisions made to prop Trump up.
Yeah, I mean, if we were getting the same, so when he would go on TV, so let's take Anderson Cooper on a Wednesday night, this is an example I use, I can't remember if we were on Wednesday or Thursday, but anyway, we were on one night, Trump was on the next, and he got 1.7 million more people watch Anderson Cooper than typically watch on that Wednesday. And then Trump goes on, he gets like 5.9 million more people. Like, it's just, so they get to sell the advertising for more. I mean, there was 25 million people watching these debates, and everybody started clamoring for the debates. I mean, they were making money. I mean, even Les Moonves, or whatever his name is, admitted as much. Like, this might be bad for the country, but it's good for CBS. That's right. And I watched the editorial control. I remember the first time, actually, in a meaningful way that I could call a reporter and have them maybe listen to me and think about what I said and actually have that impact the way they write. Not that Steve would ever be impacted by what I would say, but I always thought, well, that was kind of cool. I talked to a reporter and they wrote a story kind of based on what I was talking about. Well, in this campaign, I got to call network executives and watch them take chyrons off the bottom of the screen and replace it. I watched them stop covering things. You know, to think that they don't make these decisions
because
on that
basis.
Because
you complained about fairness, yeah. That something was too pro-Trump and you wanted that change.
Or anti-Cruz or whatever it was. Yeah, we attacked a network on the debate stage by name, used the network anchor's name, and the next day we were able to cut a deal to have them stop attacking us that we stole something from Ben Carson. When you see that, so the good news is, I remember the first time I ever did a pro media campaign. I did the Kansas City Zoo tax to bring the penguins. And I always worked against the press because I'm a right-wing knuckle dragger. And I remember they said, hey, this is the editorial we want to write. What do you think? And I'm like, that's what it's like to be a Democrat every day. Well, in a presidential campaign, well,
Said that? I mean, you're not referring to the star.
No, on a media, on a TV.
Okay.
So when they get in a situation where they're able to impact coverage and make decisions, personal decisions and professional decisions, money can't but help. And Trump was good for business.
Okay.
That's going to go around the world.
Good afternoon, Mr. Roe. Thank you for being here. So you've talked a little bit about your own resume and about managing staff on both a campaign level and in a congressional office. So my question is, what do you look for when hiring people?
And would you consider hiring
yeah,
her,
right?
I think. Yeah.
So it's pretty simple, loyalty and effort. In a campaign.
He's not an easy guy to work for. I know that much about him.
Yeah, I'm tough. I think you had like umpiring, you have to start perfect and get better. I think there's people, what people can make up in intelligence like I have, you can make up for it with commitment and work ethic. And you know the person that's always in the gym shooting baskets at the end of the day and everybody else is gone, or the quarterback out there taking snaps and that sort of thing. There's a ability to be a gym rat in politics and just hang around and work and do the things that other people won't do and really make, I mean, I'm telling you, if I can do it, anybody can do it. And it is a effort-driven commitment to it. So what do I look for? I mean, everybody has a different skill set. I don't look for anything in particular, but the hardest thing in the campaign is to get the right people in the right seat on the right bus. And so some people, if I ask them to put together a spreadsheet, they're out to lunch. Like, no way. But if I ask him to go speak in front of a group or go, like, collect, you know, bumper stickers or go out in the parking lot and put bumper stickers on people's car, that's a pretty uncomfortable request. They could do it all day long. So everybody, like, literally everybody alive could have a role in politics. It depends on what they really believe their assets are. But the trick is knowing what you're not good at. And then I think accountability is the other thing. If you say you're going to do something, you do it. And it doesn't matter what it is. And so I think loyalty and effort's the biggest thing in a campaign, because after that you can work with them And then the other thing that really makes you, that starts bringing you above, is accountability. That when you screw up, you take accountability. When you say you're going to do something, you do it. And that's what I look for in life, really, not just campaigns.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, sir. Right here.
It's been said that Hillary Clinton has a very well-funded and organized campaign. She has a lot more staff in a lot more places than Trump does. So how do you evaluate Trump's staff and his campaign effort?
You think it's going to cost him? This lack of field staff, lack of get out the vote machinery that Clinton has that Trump does not.
Yeah,
but,
I think
but you can answer your own question.
Yeah, no, I think it does. So Kellyanne's a good friend of mine. Kellyanne worked with me at the beginning.
Kellyanne Conway, Trump's campaign manager. Yeah,
Trump's campaign manager, Steve Bannon's a talented guy. Jason Miller worked for us and then went to work for them. There's a lot of talented people over there. There's a whole bunch of academic research that's done on campaigns. I mean, mountains of it. And then there's a whole bunch of people that practice campaigns, and never the two shall meet. So the reality is, if a voter gets 7 contacts from a campaign before Election Day, they're about 17% higher to vote. I mean, that's just what it is. And so how is a campaign like Trump equipped, in person, by the way, a fair number of those need to be in person. So how is a campaign equipped to touch a voter in a swing county or swing city 7 times? I just don't think they are.
7 times being the magic number.
Yeah. I mean, it's not necessarily diminishing returns, but that's a maximum. That's a maximum output right there.
He's not equipped to run that kind of campaign.
That they weren't. They haven't. They're doing some. The RNC's picked up some of that, but it's awful hard to run a generic candidate, generic, like just vote Republican, a generic candidate, generic modeled campaign. I think it could cost him a couple points, but I will say, in the counter to that, is the most powerful thing in American politics, beyond all this gobbledygook and TV commercials and all that stuff, is your neighbor telling you who they're going to vote for and asking you to join them. That is like Abraham Lincoln on through is the number one way. So people that are vote for Trump don't hide very well. They have a tendency to display themselves. If they're out talking to their neighbors, you don't have to organize that. The election were held today, I believe he loses, but the election is not today, and there's a whole bunch of people that are very fired up for him that don't need a lot of direction to do that stuff themselves. So it's hard for me to tell, because the way we would typically measure this would be based on their field staff, maybe. I mean, I don't care as much about staff. I care more about the voter communication tools that they're implementing, and they're getting better every day, the Trump campaign is. And I also think that Hillary's got she's got a motivation problem. I think if Hillary Clinton loses, every plane crash has, you know, 7 decisions. If they made another decision instead of the one they made, they would avoid the plane crash. And one of the things she did is she spent 3 months this summer trying to get moderate Republicans to vote for her. When in no way were they going to do that. They go Gary Johnson, they would maybe not vote, but they're not going to. It's like a left-handed shortstop. You know the names of Republicans that are openly voting for her. And she spent millions of dollars, which is important, but more than that, 90 days trying to get Republicans to vote for her when they're just not going to do that. And she should have been motivating her base. All the while, awkwardly, Donald continually motivates his base in very unusual terms. But she spent a lot of time in a time when it is a base election turnout. There are 23 million white men without a college degree that haven't voted and can. 23 million. This is after Romney lost by 5 million. And she's trying to mess around to get of where he's winning 80-20. He's literally beating her by 59 points. It's a big number of people. You take a county, and I'll just briefly go through this. Clay County is a county that I'm speaking of. Clay County is a swing.
Just north of Kansas City. We're part of Kansas City. Yeah.
It's a swing. It's where Clay Como is, and World's of Fun. So Clay County, Abraham Lincoln didn't get a single vote in Clay County. So it's been going Republican ever since. And George W. Bush lost to Al Gore in 2000 by one vote out of like 80,000 cast. And then John McCain beat Obama by 800 votes, roughly. Somebody probably fact check me on this, but roughly 800 votes in a time when he was winning by like 5,000 votes statewide. And then the next open election is now, and in every poll that I've seen, Donald Trump is going to win Clay County by like 15,000 votes. That is a predominantly a white, no college education male county that has been historically the swingiest of the swing, and they're just bolting for the doors to go vote for Trump. So does he need that? Does he need that ground game? Does he need that seven connects?
Well, you've always said until now that he does.
I believe that it's critical, but I would also say that the temperament in the polls and my dispute of some of the polls and seeing how the poor campaign that Hillary herself has administered, I think her campaign is good. I only measure that. I don't follow how many stats. I mean, I read the stats, but they won every close race against Sanders. And if you win every close race, like at some point you're doing something pretty well. And so I believe that they had that figured out. And I do believe it could cost Trump 2.5. It should cost him 2.5 points anyway. What I can't measure any longer is how he has run up the score and she abandoned. Mm-hmm. I mean, the last time I talked publicly about this, she had not completely abandoned her base. Now she's coming back to her base and using Barack and Michelle to do it. I think that was always their plan. Go get the soft Republicans and then use Barack and Michelle at the end to rally our base. That has not proven to be transferable to another candidate yet. So I'll have to
okay,
see.
Final thing.
Yeah, sorry.
Final thing. We're 5 weeks from today is Election Day. We've seen a Trump surge. Now Hillary is surging. Where are we? Where are we going? Oh, wise one.
Yeah, wise one, right? Bet on me. I would have been here 2 years ago telling you Ted Cruz was going to be the nominee. So take this for a grain of salt. I think that Trump will win. And audible. Make America great again, boys. Here's why I think he will. If you take a look at the swing states, think about this. Ohio is gone. Ohio's going for Trump. If you think about a Republican nominee that's going to win Florida, win Iowa. I'm sorry. He is going to win Iowa, too. But take out the names and say a Republican is going to win Ohio, Florida, Iowa. Are they going to be the president? The answer to that's yes. And Florida's not baked yet, but Florida's, even with this Clinton surge, like here's what you can measure. The best day of the campaign and Hillary Clinton is not putting him away. It's still a margin of error race and she just had the best week of her campaign and he's still within two or three. And when we have, you know, a country that is so divided and he can do the things he can do and he's still got a really high floor, that means to me that Pennsylvania's in play. And Pennsylvania is, we do some polling there and do some work in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania is like a really big Clay County. And when you have a Republican playing offense in a state that we should never be in, and Trump is doing the kind of work in Pennsylvania that can happen, that he's doing with the numbers there, they have suburbs that are bad, and Philly suburbs, I get it. But I don't know. I think he'll win. I think it'll be close. And I think on election night, because they report early, go look at Tampa, Florida. I think it's Jefferson County. No, it's not Jefferson. You'll have to look it up at home. Hillsborough County. Hillsborough County, very good, sir. Hillsborough County is a swing county in the state. It's a part of that I-4 corridor that everybody talks about, which is all kind of leaning Trump now. It's an early state. It's an early county to report. You can look at that and watch and see how Tampa goes, and that may be a real indicator for the rest of the country.
You know, Jeff Roe came a long way from Houston, Texas, to be with us today. Let's give him a big round of applause for being here. Thanks for coming. So good to have you here. We are off next week, but then the following week, Steve Jakes will be here. We're going to talk about the role of an advance man in presidential politics and what that's all about, how to stage an event exactly the right way to affect maximum TV exposure. There's a science behind it. Steve Jakes will be here to tell us all about it 2 weeks from today. Thanks for coming today.
That's pretty
cool. Good to see you. You bet.
Who do you work for? What's that? Who do you work for?